And getting in, just a few problems with the keys. Basically, this is a public meeting that's been called by the Granby Residents Association. For those of you who don't know exactly who we are and what we are, we're a group that were unhappy with the current proposals for the Granby Triangle. So we got ourselves together some 14 weeks ago, and we've been meeting regularly since then, and trying to take some action concerning the future of our community. A couple of the things that we want to cover within this meeting are the actual report that the Housing Associations and the Council have prepared between them concerning the future of the community. And also Anna and Dorothy will be reporting back on some of the sort of more current issues related to our meetings with the Council and other officials. Among the issues that were maybe discussed this evening was the consultation process itself. We have made a number of complaints about it to members of the council, to Max Steinberg, who's the chair of the Housing Corporation, and to Michael Maunders, who's the chair of Council Housing. And I think.
Okay, well, what I'm going to run through first, people who've been to our regular meetings, you've heard all this, so this is for the benefit of anyone who hasn't been before, maybe not for a few weeks. We raised a number of concerns about the actual consultation process. I know that personally I wasn't happy with the approach on the doorstep, and quite a lot of our members have had complaints to make about that. Issues were raised such as problems with the drains and sewers and also underground streams. Now, we have in fact contacted North West Water, and I've got a letter from them clearly stating that there isn't any problem with the drains or sewers in the Granby area, and also stating that they hadn't had any contact with any housing people at that point. The underground streams do exist, but they appear to only affect a very small number of properties at the end of Arundel, Eversley and Cawdor at the Mulgrave and Princess Avenue end, and that certainly isn't really a reason for total demolition. Obviously we appreciate that it affects his houses, will have to be demolished, and we're not blocking that move at all. We also felt there was a serious lack of information given out during the process. There was no information really at all offered to shops and businesses, and for a lot of people this is the sole income. I think it's an important issue that needs looking at. There was also no real information for owner occupiers. We have been told that both these issues are still being looked at, but we still haven't got any firm, you know, written evidence of exactly what looking at means. We tonight can't tell you anything about shops or owner occupiers. There's also the case of there's going to be a shortfall of housing. Now, we don't know who is not going to get offered a new property in the area or where these people are likely to be relocated. Another issue that we've uncovered is that Peter Lilly, who is, I believe, the Minister for Social Security, is currently reviewing housing benefits. Now, later on this year, there's going to be a ceiling limit put on housing benefits, which means that people on benefits won't receive their full housing benefit money, or may not. And now this is in an attempt to make benefits look cheaper accommodation. So prices that we're looking at for the new rents, this could lead to a lot of people in the Grand Triangle being forced out and looking for cheaper accommodation. And in fact, we found out in the last fortnight that there's talk of housing benefits being cut altogether in 1997. So I think we all need to look very long term at the implications of what's happening with the housing benefits at the moment, because it could lead to a lot of people being either relocated or even homeless in the next 3 or 4 years. We've also heard of a plan, which I'm sure you've all heard of before over the last 10 years, which is an M62 link road, which is planned to go through part of the Grand Triangle. Now, a lot of people have dismissed this issue because it's been tabled again and again over the last 10 years. I think the point isn't the fact that it's been around for so long. The point is it's back on the table now, being discussed in council. I have got copies of minutes of Planning Policy and Resource Committee meetings where they are rediscussing this new road. And I think in light of the proposed demolition, this is probably something that they're very seriously looking at. And I think we all need to think about whether we want a motorway running right past our homes. Okay, back to how people were approached on the doorstep. A lot of people were given the impression that this was very much a foregone conclusion and they really didn't have very much say in it. We brought these matters up over the last 3 months, 3.5 months now, numerous times in meetings, also in letters to various people. We've still got no information. They've still released no information to us. Now, that in itself is illegal. There are laws stating that information like that must be made public. And we have informed Max Steinberg that we are actually going to the Parliamentary Ombudsman over this issue, because big decisions are being made about our future. And when we ask to see some of the information that's informing those decisions, for instance, there isn't enough money to regenerate, that may well be true. But if they can't show us the evidence, if they can't show us the written documentation that shows there's no money for regeneration or renovation, sorry, I personally am still sceptical. So to move on, I mean, we do recognise that there's a lot of people who want different things in the triangle. Some people want to stay in the house that they've got. Some people may want to stay in the house they've got if they can get some improvements done on it. Some people definitely want a new home, and some people want to move out of the area. We don't want to stop anybody achieving those aims. You know, we want to represent as much of the community as we want, and we feel strongly that the only way to make sure that the maximum number of people get satisfaction out of this process is if we all work together as a community. Now, I've spoken to a number of people who are in favour of demolition, because their house, which they rent off a housing association or private landlord, is currently in very bad condition. I've been told stories of horrific damp, overrun with rats. Now, I've heard some really horrific stories. Now, I'm not obviously going to deny these people a better standard of living, but I'm not convinced in all cases that the houses need to be demolished to achieve a better standard of living. If you're living in rented accommodation and it's not in proper condition, livable condition, you're not happy with, you've got several legal ways of getting that situation put right. There's Housing Association Ombudsman, there's the Local Government Ombudsman, which covers council properties. You can see a solicitor. So, and we would be more than happy to help anybody who's in that situation get their complaints heard and try and get those repairs done. People shouldn't be living in substandard accommodation. There's just no excuse for it, not in these days. If people are waiting for a transfer, I've also spoken to quite a lot of people who've been on transfer lists for really unacceptable length of times. We're talking months and years. That's not right either. These people have a legal obligation to rehouse people. Again, if there's anything we can do to assist, we can lobby politically, locally, we can get local organisations involved. If we can help people to get rehoused where they want to be, that's what we want to do. We're not just standing up here and saying, we want our homes kept, they can't be under demolition. We're trying to set up a residence organisation to represent the views of as many people as possible. And in time, if we're able to get some funding and stuff in, we'd also like to tackle slightly less important issues such as street cleaning. The streets getting swept regularly, the bins getting emptied properly, the back entries getting cleaned out properly. Street lighting doesn't work in half the streets half the time. There's a problem with rats in the area. We want to try and address all of these issues so that for everyone who lives in the So towards those ends, we're currently drafting a constitution, which is basically a document stating that you're an organisation. It's quite a long legal document. When that's finished, we will be a recognised organisation and we'll be able to go for proper funding from a number of organisations. So once we get that going, we'll have more resources to do a lot of the things that I've just been talking about. That's briefly a summary of the complaints that we've raised and also some of the things that we'd like to try and do as an association. I was going to ask Bobby Mohammed, who's our treasurer, to give a brief financial report, but I haven't actually had a chance to speak to Bobby, so it's not very fair to dump that on him right now. So if I may, I'll give a brief financial report back to date. Unfortunately, there have still been a few problems with the bank account. We do have a cheque for £100 from an anonymous source in Manchester. So we'll be opening the account with £100. I've also been promised a donation from another one of our members, I believe it's about £50. And of course, there's our weekly take-ins, which currently stands at £93, not including tonight. So once the account's open, we'll have about £250. That's going to enable us to buy stationery, get stamps for people. If people want to write their own letters and complain, we can supply them with the stamps and stationery. We've also got the information of who it is you should be complaining to. So that's something to look forward to in the next few weeks.
I'd just like to raise the issue of the report that is now actually available, and Tracy Gore, who's sitting at the back there, does have a couple of copies. Hopefully we'll be able to get some more of these by next Wednesday's meeting, or we can have these photocopied so that everyone can have a copy of this. Basically, we met, despite the fact that it says the final report on the consultation process, we did in fact meet with Max Steinberg Friday of last week, and he has now said to us that he doesn't feel that the consultation process is complete, despite the fact that previously it was, you know, always going to be a 6-week consultation process with the report coming out. He now says that he sees the need for a partnership to come together between existing community organisations, the housing associations, and ourselves, right? Now, that, if you like, is rather a large turnaround on the previous position. Previous to now, it's always been, well, let's wait for the report and see what is being said by it. He does seem to recognise now that they can't really move forward without us. There's enough of us for us to have made them take some sort of notice now. So he wants to continue meeting with us to discuss possible ways of at least getting around some of the problems. Now, my impression of what he has actually been coming across with is that he basically wants to start negotiating, particularly with those people that own their own properties. You know what I mean? Now, whether he wants to negotiate he has mentioned a possible partial demolition. Now, obviously, for owner-occupiers, if there's only a partial demolition, that's going to leave some people very happy and other people very unhappy. So we've actually said nothing about this. We've just said, you know, our actual members will have to be consulted about this as and when it comes along. But there does seem to be, now, they want to speak to us. They've realised that they can't just go over our heads and ignore us. Do you know what I mean? They seem to want some sort of working partnership to actually take place now. Exactly how they want that to work and what issues they want to discuss is still not clear. But they do want to have dialogue with us ongoing.
What's partial demolition?
It could mean anything from them only taking the minimum number of properties to them taking roughly half what they want to take. Instead of them knocking down everything between Eversley and Beaconsfield, they might take only the top of the streets, only the bottom of the streets. They may only take Eversley and leave the others. They're not really being clear about it, but what they are saying is that they realise that there is grounds for us to have a working partnership with them to at least discuss the future.
Thank you.
We don't want that, though. We had a meeting 2 years ago, and the council agreed to take 11 houses from 1 to 11 in the bottom of corridor, and 3 more houses. And how come they want to take half this year and half of that there? They're trying to con us off.
Well, I mean,
wouldn't wear that.
Yeah, my
stick to what the council said. Because at first, I'm only talking, at first, in the meeting in the town hall, you was abroad, and you're on your message abroad. The Free Housing Association people stand up there and was waving a paper, and he was showing us graphics of the what they want, and says, no way are we going to do these houses over. He tell us, you take it or leave it, and your rents would be 90 to 120 pounds. So I don't know what that smart thing they're coming with the fool of the thing with that.
The issue of no refurbishment north of Beaconsfield Street is one that I've been pursuing quite sort of fervently with Max Steinberg, the chairman of the Housing Corporation. And what he has said to me at this point is that he didn't, at that meeting that you're referring to now, he did make a policy decision, or he did stand up and say there is no money for properties north of Beaconsfield Street. Since then, we've discovered that any agency such as the Housing Corporation that makes a public policy and states it like that, they have to give us the information that led to that policy. The information that informed that policy must be provided. Now, when I met with him on Friday, I did say to him, I demand that information, and if you don't give it to me, I will be writing to the Parliamentary Ombudsman, at which time he said he would have a letter out to me a week, Monday just gone. Which at least would give me a firm date of when that information would be available. Because this is it, they seem to just stand up and say, we're not doing this. When we said to them that we wanted the information, they said it was in packs that were very, very difficult to understand.
We wouldn't be able to understand.
Oh, why?
Well, I did point out to them that I could get a solicitor, an accountant, and a housing expert to look at them all independently and understand them for me. Or I could read them and ask them questions about anything that we didn't understand.
Yeah.
But there is a general reluctance now. That one issue seems to be something that we're making ground on, because basically they've never released the information, despite the fact that that statement, that meeting was in February, I think.
February.
Yeah, of this year. Well, we've made repeated requests for the information that supports that policy, and it has not been forthcoming. So we're giving them up until next Monday to give us a date when that information will be available. And then again, we'll be going over their heads direct to the Parliamentary Ombudsman, and have an investigation launched in central government about it.
Okay, part of what we've also done, because, I mean, a number of the issues that we're raising, we feel are important. A number of the issues we're raising are legally very significant. So, following on with these meetings, we have been contacting both local and national politicians. We've written to Sir George Young, who's the Minister for Housing and the government. I haven't had a response from him yet, but I understand it normally does take about 5 weeks to get a letter back from him, and it's only been 3 to 4 now, so hopefully we'll be back from him soon. We have had a letter back from John Battle, who's the Labour spokesman for housing. He's been very supportive, although he does suggest that we try and motivate our local councillors and MP to do something. Now, I have repeatedly contacted Patronum, actually, Gideon Bentovin and Peter Tyrrell, who are our three councillors. I've written to them all three times and I've had no response.
They're gangsters, though.
Which speaks for
itself.
I personally want
to tell
Sorry. I apologise to Peter Tyrrell, I haven't met him before.
You may have written to me, but I'm sure I only have two letters. One was for the meeting, the other week, it was cancelled, and one was tonight.
But I've written to you, and I've had an acknowledgement of the letter.
Yes.
I wrote to you at your home address.
Okay, well, I apologise to Peter
Tyrrell. I just wanted to ask some questions, sir. I mean, why is it made? The assumption the Housing Association had given us is that the only problem is that they're unoccupied.
Well, one of the issues that we've been trying to raise throughout this campaign is basically the fact that what the housing associations have done, in our opinion, is they've actually said to people, you know, people who want new houses because their houses are in need of repair, people who want transfers out of the area, have basically been told that this plan is a means to an end. If you want your new house, vote yes to demolition. Now, what we're saying is people have a right, a statutory right, to decent housing. They have a statutory right to the right kind of accommodation, but it doesn't mean that their existing property has to be demolished.
Sorry,
can I
amend
it? Because I was actually quite heavily involved in the consultation process, and I have to disagree with what you've just said there.
terms of the consultation process, what we actually said to our tenants was what we said to everybody, which we explained what the Heart Association proposals were, what we thought, the same path that, you know, you've all seen, we went through them with everybody. We didn't say to them, this is the only way you're going to get a transfer fuel piece of this. And we did not say to them, this is the only way your house...
No, okay, I take the point, Tracy, you didn't actually make them statements, but one of the statements...
That's what you just said.
One of the statements that was consistently made is either this plan goes ahead or it will stay pretty much the same as it has been.
Yeah.
And that for people...
Take this or leave it out your boat. We're taking the houses anyway. So don't give us no crap. Don't give us crap. That wasn't my house. And the same legit this.
Just have a point of order. I think the point that I was trying to make, Tracy, although the quote that I made wasn't specific to any individual housing officer, was that the implication was this plan goes forward or things on Granby remain as they are now. Well, everybody who's here is well aware of the fact that we can't leave things remaining as they are now with dozens of empty properties per street.
No, but it can be done up yet.
But it is in fact the policy of LHT not to actually improve any properties and to brick them up.
And they segregated
across
the
number of
the housing trust.
Can I just say to Peter Tyrrell that even the Housing Association's own report shows, even though we disagree with the way the whole thing has been packaged, it shows that there are tenants against the demolition.
Of course.
It's not just to do with households. And can I just finish? Those sort of comments are being used to divide the community,
yeah,
as if somehow or other the big wealthy house owners, which were not, my house cost 4,000 16 years ago, and the poor tenants are, you know, the house owners are stopping the poor tenants getting housing, and it's all part of the tactics, and that's why it's important we get together under a residence association to collectively make decisions about the future of this neighbourhood,
sure,
not leave it in the hands of outsiders.
I'm not here tonight to support either the report from the Housing Association or the report from the local authority. I'm here tonight as the elected representative of this ward to find out what the problems are for the people who live here and the people who elected me. And them people have genuine problems and genuine grievances. I promise you here and now, I will pursue them with you. That's what I'm here for. I'm not here to support either the City Council position on it or the Housing Association position on it. I'm here to listen and to ask the people of this ward who voted for me what questions they wish to pursue neither the local authority or the Housing Corporation. I haven't got a problem with that. But I agree that there is other issues which should be aired, particularly the one on the people who want to rent houses. When the housing plan is cut and taken from me, it will be cut. Are the people who are going to live in rented accommodation going to be able to afford it? That is a live issue and it's got to be discussed. But as I said, I'm not here to defend the local authority position or the Housing Association. My prime duty is to represent the people that voted for me. And the people that voted for me have genuine grievances. Tell me and write them down what their grievances are. I will pursue them later. I haven't got a problem.
Yeah. Another thing, the Housing Association. They have the right to buy our house. We haven't got the right to buy theirs. What they want to do is get us part owner. If I take part owner and I die, my wife can't get that house, it goes back to them. So why should I have my house? I have my house. I pay for my house.
I'm old. In a public meeting, when you get
it, I'm on a pension. And these comments are the part owner
one. Only one of you can speak at a time.
What I'm saying.
Listening till they finish speaking. If you've got a point to make, speak when they've finished. Even if you don't agree with what they've got to say, we've all got the right to speak. So I think we need to start showing each other a little bit more respect.
Precisely. Yeah.
Yeah.
They want their own money.
Can I just say that Cecil and other people's anger is a reflection of a very strong feeling about... Please, Cecil, there's a very strong feeling about the way people have been treated in relation to the survey. To find suddenly a letter through your door telling you that you may, your house will possibly be demolished. And you, I mean, the questions you ask people indicate that you can't even promise people a house back in the same area, let alone in the same street. It's caused a great deal of distress and a great deal of stress and anger. And, you know, so it shouldn't be surprised if people are jumping up and down about what's been going on. And in relation to what you said, Peter, about, you know, people in rented housing, the fact is some of us paid our mortgages. And we might end up in rented housing with rents we can't afford. I cannot afford a £50 a week rent. That's the minimum rent we're being offered. I paid mortgages so I wouldn't be free of paying rent as I got older. The Housing Association are offering me poverty in my old age. For the first time in my life, I'll have to go and seek housing benefit if it exists. And if it doesn't exist, I'll also be among the homeless. And I'm not exaggerating when I say this. So, you know, there's a whole issue here of what it's going to do to people who've worked hard to keep their independence. And Cecil and other people have every right to be angry and distressed.
But we know we've robbed a lot of people of their homes, especially old people, and the segregation of people are not. They've robbed
Dorothy,
everything off us.
This is my dear
house.
They've
robbed our shops, they've robbed everything off us. What little shops we've got left, we want them preserved. We want them fixed up.
Yeah.
You know, we want grants to do them up.
Yeah.
We want our fish shop open again.
Yeah.
We want our post office open again.
That's it.
Well, that has been one of the issues that we have made.
Every other area's got these facilities.
Yeah. We
always had them, but they robbed them off us.
Yeah, we have made strenuous kind of, you know, comments.
Do you know, I lived
this,
in a house in Newmont Street for 22 years. City Council, for 22 years. They decided to turn this house back to front. My house is right on the pavement. I lived on the pavement for 22 years and went through that. So when I refused to stay in the house, I said, all right, then, you go and find the house that you want in the area. And I just went to Beaconsfield Street and they gave me the house. And now after 12 months, they told me it's getting demolished. So I spent a lot of money on my house. It's a beautiful house. It's a beautiful house. It's only the outside that needs pointing and the roof and the look of it. Not much money needs spending on it. You know what I mean? Inside is perfect.
The issue of shops and businesses is one that we have actually made a lot of noise about with them, because although there are plans...
I know Granby Street from a little girl like that. I lived on Granby Street all my life.
Although there are plans to demolish a number of the existing business premises, at this point in time, there is no plans and no money to build any new ones. Not any.
Well, what about all the money they got from the European?
Well, the money talk with them is...
That be spent on housing.
Yeah, on businesses.
But we can do.
But our shops are the businesses.
Yeah.
But I think
our
one
shops
of,
are business.
Yeah. I think one of the things that we intend to do in the near future is what we would like to do is we'd like to approach the housing associations, Max Steinberger, the Housing Corporation, and the council. And we've decided
and the Liverpool Housing Trust that's causing all the trouble.
The Liverpool
Housing
Trust
that's
causing all the
trouble.
Well,
there's a lady over there.
Excuse me, there's a lady on this side who hasn't had a chance to speak yet.
I'd like to say this. I'm an owner-occupier, and I've been in the house nearly 60 years. Now, the house is deteriorating because of the time I've got to wait for decisions to be made. And it's upsetting me because I don't know where I am. Also, another point, the area is becoming a real refuse dump.
Yes.
The refuse that's dumped in the streets just because it's Liverpool 8 seems to be very prevalent. The top of Cawdor Street 2 weeks ago, someone dumped two huge boxes of dog excrement from a large dog, and that's what we have to put up with. They're throwing their rubbish anywhere now. Would you like to live in those circumstances?
Well, we live in the area. Yeah.
Well, of course you do.
I also
have mice. I have to have the men up every so often to put the poison down. And until the house is done or whatever you're going to do with it, I'm in that position. So who would like to live like that?
The Housing Association would like you to.
Oh,
the
boys. And like you say, it's our shops. We need our shops. I don't want to leave the area. I love the area.
Yeah.
Well, the corporation want to go in the top of Gordon Street and remove the rubbish out of their 20 houses.
Oh, yes, that's
and maybe
point.
We'll get rid of the rats and the mice. Yeah. But every time you go down, the corporation don't want to know.
Now, there's two...
Because you live in Liverpool Lane, you're no good.
That's true.
Their attitude.
You're treated like scum, and I've noticed that. Now, another point is that the empty houses in the yards, they're full of refuse. Now, 6 years ago, one of my neighbours and myself did everything we could. We had inspectors up and everything to view these things. But nothing was done. They're in still the same filthy condition. The yards are full of blue bottles. And that's no lie.
And, they
and that's what
bags.
They're left to live with.
They throw their rubbish over the wall rather than put it in
and
a plastic bag.
And filthy napkins coming over your wall from babies. And that's the truth. No lies there.
And the corporation property is in good repair in them too.
Well, where are
in
they?
In terms of the near future, one of the things that we hope to do with the housing associations and the council and the housing corporation is we've decided now that we'd like to ask them to show us, right? I'd like to invite them to show all of us people here the last place that they knocked down 400 terraced houses and built one of these wonderful new build schemes. We want to see where it's worked. And if it hasn't been done previously, we'd like to ask why we're the guinea pigs. Because I don't know any schemes locally where they've knocked down 400 houses and built an estate that is anything like what anybody would like to live on. And I think that is a really valid point to put forward to them.
And who wants their corporation house to put back there? The likes of us wouldn't even stand a chance. You're going to take your pension. You better just not deliver a pension book to us. Just keep it and pay for everything. And then let's see how we live. We'll be living on the blinking streets.
Right. Andy, did you want to come in there?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes, you would. If you've got to pay £60 a week.
Please, can we just...
Sorry, it's just that for those people
who
don't know, we have from the Blue House and Trust.
If I can just clarify for everyone,
just to go back to the beginning of the, I realise all the issues about the consultation, but the three associations of in the area would ask to do a consultation by the City Council, reading the results, so I know I won't go into this. The council has to make some decisions about the future of the area, including things like the shop, community facilities, and so on. So, to be fair to LHT, if you like, I don't know what to do, but to be fair to them, it isn't all about what LHT is doing on this journey, neither is it all about MIH. It's about everyone doing something together, the city council, the community organisations, and the associations. And I realise.
We've got
to
come
to
that
meeting,
they should call it and not dominate our meeting.
We'll report
it back.
It's just that you're raising points that
you've got speakers here to move these things forward.
I do not wholly agree with what I'm saying. According to my limited information, but my experience in the area, which is not limited, it would appear that consultation has been made. But now, from what the residents are saying, adequate consultation has not been carried out. Also, the housing associations which are operating in the area, from what is now emerging, it would appear one housing association has got more property in the area. In the area too, there are people who own property. And these people they have got their estate. If they are to be removed from the area, is that transfer temporary or permanent? And who is going to make a deal in terms of their property? How is it going to be arranged? Because as far as we know, the people are well aware, when they buy property, they also know their rights. They might have even bought this property from the city council based on the policy of encouraging the tenants to buy their own because they can afford. Now, rules are changing. Who is going to provide them with security? And if we are to take it one by one, if that consultation has not been fully carried out, why don't we say, then let there be a proper and fair consultation that must first start with the property owners. They should have their own dialogue. Because these property owners, they need to know whom are they going to enter into negotiation. Is it the city councils, the housing associations, who would want to buy their property, or who would want to have some sort of partnership with them? Where will the money come from?
I don't want a partnership for nobody. Why should
this got to be made clear. The tenants of the...
I don't want to sell my house at all.
Please,
we're talking
finish.
About selling my...
Please, Cecil.
I don't agree
He's
with
got
everything.
A right to express his view, you know.
All right. That's good. The tenants that are under the city council, what are the provisions made for them? The same with the housing associations. As we know, this is a social issue. It should not be evaded. There should be no intrigues of some political tactics being played here and there. We've got to be very clear, this is a social problem. We have 400 people. If they are displaced overnight, the whole lot is demolished. You take them into bed and breakfast or areas where they may not even like this, sort of a psychological attachment and emotional appeal to the area where they have been brought up. So why don't you look at these issues adequately and then try to see and establish a dialogue where meaningful negotiation and reasonable compromise is rich. In that you have to care for them, you are not just dumbing them as it is now happening, that it is a dumbing ground for all those. When will that negotiation take place rather than being played in a very tactical, sleazy and very intriguing manner? Is that politics? Is that a caring attitude? Is that the way we can serve ourselves? Is the money not available? When it was picked up as a project, you shouldn't pick up a project if you have not had plans for it. I am sure the housing associations, the city council, must have already negotiated a deal before thinking of making changes here. What has happened? Is the money not enough?
Good point.
Thank you.
No.
Okay. Move on. I think John Hanson would like to say something.
Okay. First of all, this is my first meeting here.
Yeah.
And I'm listening to what's being said, because I've had papers from Dr. Kuya, some of these papers here, that give me the background before I came to the meeting, and I'm listening to what's being said here. So you'll understand that I've no responsibility in the area now, although I had a long period of time as your councillor, and I know some of the very much the area and what has happened in the district. The time when I just left the council, I remember we had a consultation then in Lodge Lane Library. At that time, in the housing department, had a whole argument about what they should do to the area. And there was an exhibition then, and a form to fill up. So there's been dozens of these forms filling up as what people want in the area. And from long experience with this sort of thing, of course you will find some people want to stay, some people want to go, some people don't know, some people want to stay in the old house and others want to go into a new one in the area. And you'll get that sort of picture, whatever you do, in the way of a survey. So I'm very doubtful about surveys in the sense of proving things. You prove things by what questions you ask people. And if you ask the certain questions, you'll get the answers you want. And if you miss out certain questions, you'll miss out some of the important things that are in the back of people's minds and only come out later. So the first thing I would say is be careful of surveys. And all people should be involved in the questions that are going to be asked in a survey. It's not should be one side asking the survey, it should be everybody, so that you're quite certain that the questions you're asking are going to produce answers which you know really reflect what the area wants. That's the first thing. The second thing is this. It's a dangerous thing, and I've been involved in it myself, of turfing out a whole area to destroy the whole lines of communication of a community. And it's a very strong, interlocking thing. It's very, very important to those people. You've been mentioning shops and so on. There's all sorts of things. Goodness knows, you had a row just recently about the post office in Lodge Lane and the question of where you could get your pensions there.
Yeah.
All that sort of thing is involved. And Granby Street post office as well. So all those sort of things have to be considered if a whole area is going to be demolished and you're just going to dump people into it. I remember the days and on Old Street and so on, everybody was travelling to go to Netherley from this area. And I was back at the time. And everybody, as soon as they got out there, were clamouring to get back.
Oh yeah.
Because they didn't want the houses that they'd left in Old Street. They wanted to get rid of those. They wanted better houses. But they lost a whole lot of communications and people and labours and so on and facilities that they had. They've got terrible bus services now and all the rest of it. You have to remember today that the laws have been changed in this country. And you've got a certain, I don't know, everybody will be different here, but some of you will have certain protection rights under the Housing Act, which once you go into a new property, you lose those protection rights. All sorts of things, protected rents and so on, may be there. Now, I couldn't say, I don't know about every individual in this room, it would have to be carefully investigated. But some people could lose a lot by losing the protection of their rents and protection of their tenancy, which under new housing legislation means you've got very little protection. Tenants have got very little now. Even on the housing association or to the council. And therefore I'm saying that when you look at the idea of going out and getting out of your place, look at what you're going to lose in protection. Even the question of repairing a house and modernising it. You take the water authority as a simple example. If you go into renovated property now, the water authority puts you on a water meter and you don't pay a water rent. It's going to be a water meter based on the amount of water you use. So if you go into new property, straight away, you will pay for the water you use in the same way you pay for electricity bills.
Scandalous.
And instead of paying a standard amount of money for the whole year, whatever water you need, and for a young family with children and so on, or somebody that's old with an illness that needs a lot of water and so on, they pay the standard water rates at the present moment. Whatever you use, whether you use only a drop of water, a cup full of water, or whether you use bathfuls of water a day. But under the new tenancy agreement, whether it's a renovated house or a new house, you will not be under a water rent, water rate. You'll then come under how much water you use. And the young families will pay a lot more for the water. The families of people old who have to use water because of their illness and so on will pay more than somebody that doesn't need very much water, and it's going to hit those that are hardest hit in already. Now, that's one little aspect, the whole thing. You've got to look at that. You've got to look at the question of what the heating is going to be in the new type of property. And there's going to be all sorts of charges with VAT coming in on that business, and the fuel charges. Check on that. One thing again that I would say here is that all bodies, and I talk from experience here, all bodies you ought to see from their agendas who is saying what to who. the council agenda, the housing association, whatever one it is, or you must all have the same agenda with the same information. And you don't want to find that one body has a different type of information to get a result out of them than another body. Now again, that's a simple thing, but from my own personal experience, I see this. If you're not careful, somebody is told one thing and gets them to agree to that. Another person is told something else and they agree to that. Before you know where you are, you're all at cross purposes with one another. If the housing association and the council are going to work together with you, they've got to work together with you at all levels, including their agendas, so that you know what each other's saying and what you're agreeing to. I'm just giving you practical, obvious points that you've got to think about. I'm not going to persuade you one way or another in the sense of speaking, but on the other hand, I'm just telling you, be extremely careful with what you're going into, because like everybody else, if you're buying your own property, very often you get a solicitor or a surveyor to do the work for you. Now, you've got to be equally on that level if you're going into rented property and a housing association property, because you've got to know exactly what you're going to put yourself into. Properties in this area, and I can remember around Bulgrave Street, which were demolished and they were poor.
Yeah,
they needed pulling down. So I'm talking about the old houses,
yeah,
going back 20 or 30 years now.
Yeah.
They were needed demolition, but they built houses there. God knows they've been pulling them down.
Yeah.
And so I know the situation. I'm seeing the things. I can remember going back in history in Berkeley Street, fighting the Minister of Housing at that time, Dr. Hill, who was now dead, but he was the radio doctor. Stopping him in Berkeley Street with Mrs. Simey to get Berkeley Street demolished. And we got the multi-story flats built there. We stopped Dr. Hill. They're all demolished now. And here I am still alive. But that's in a lifetime. And I'm warning you. And those people had problems. They all went into those multi-story flats. I remember it well. One cold winter. Pushed the heat up because it was all underfloor heating, got enormous electric bills that they couldn't face, and they all got turfed out because they couldn't pay their bills. All that I would say, I will help and give my advice to you as an impartial observer, if you like, with no interest in the thing myself, no personal interest in what happens here. I'm not going to get anything out of this at all, and I'm not representing the area, but I'll give you what information and advice I can give as a person with an experience in this sort of thing. And all that I would say to you, well, I won't come every meeting, but if you want my help, certainly use it. But I would suggest very much the points that I am making. Watch what agreements you come to, watch what surveys are being done, watch exactly where the money's coming from and how it's being spent, and whether there isn't a possibility of repairing houses rather than putting people
that's
out.
Right, yeah. Nice,
now,
yeah.
Some of those where the floor and the foundations have gone may have to be demolished. I know that the Water Authority didn't need, they did have a situation with the circumference of the piping in the area. It was small in the days when there was only cold water pipes here. But they've had a new method of doing things, and they've been around this area. There was a big problem of the main supply pipe down Prince's Avenue, which has been repaired, because I was on the Water Authority in those days, and I know exactly the surveys that were going on in this area at the time. But all that I would say, watch extremely carefully what you're putting yourselves into. Don't be afraid of saying to the council and the housing association, I want to know my rights and what you're presenting to me. I want everything, the facts laid on the paper, on the table, and I want all of them to agree with one another so that we all know exactly what we're saying to each other and we're not at cross purposes.
Right, I'd just like to clarify one of the points that John was making then. In terms of water meters, I am told that if a major refurbishment of a property takes place, that water meters are also installed. Yeah. But I think the point that I did make to Max Steinberg several times at our last meeting was, how do LHC, MIH, CDS and the council all are running national campaigns against water meters? Now, considering Liverpool has just been given Objective 1 status by Europe, which in effect means that we're one of the poorest cities in Europe, and this is one of the poorest areas in the poorest city in Europe, or one of them, then I did actually ask them why all four of these organisations have come up with a policy that includes us all having water meters, because each of them individually campaign against it.
Scandalous. We can't live as it is.
Just on the water meter issue, I think it is right to ask the Arden Corporation. But I've asked a question to the Arden Corporation and the government and the Arden Association. The City Council can pass a policy to say we will not have water meters on our property. Why cannot the Arden Association?
Well, I don't know.
Mean, it's a question that being asked, we've asked it. The City Council has a clear policy we will not have water meters on our property. The question has to be asked, if it's legal for the City Council to declare a policy of we will not have water meters, why is it not the Association?
Another thing you can do is the compulsory purchase. Aren't you? But why don't you tell that?
No.
Tell them off.
Water meters are concerned. I've been told by people who live around the Dove Street, more than one, that those houses who need to take action, which have very recently been improved, is a council house. I'm told they do not have water meters. Those that are new do have water meters, brand new houses. And of course, some people are annoyed because they should have cost. Don't have meters. So as far as I know, at the moment, improved houses, at this particular time, it may change in 4 months, houses which are improved, as far as I know, don't have water meters.
Right.
But I know
about that. Some council houses have just built about...
Brand new ones, doing that.
Yeah, and they put a water meter in.
Brand new ones, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, I think the basic principle is why all of these organisations actually can say we run campaigns and we're opposed to this in principle. However, it's on our plans for your area. I mean, for me, there's a massive contradiction there that doesn't seem to make any sense. On one hand, they're all against it, but their plans for this area include water meters, which for me, as I say, we're going to move on now, and Kensley. Excuse me, please look. I'm only a young man here. Most of the people in this room are older than me, and it makes me feel very difficult.
Respect.
If I have to actually ask people that are more senior to myself.
Thank you.
I'm back to see.
Okay. Corporation.
go down from them to pay for all of this. Now I feel that it's feasible. If people are turning around saying it's too expensive and things like that. We all pay rates, taxes or whatever, so we think we're all going to be here for a long time. So that's a natural investment. That's actually our money there. That's what we spend on our area. So I feel very strongly that this group should register at what's called the Development Trust and then go down, get a package together, present it to the City Council, to the Housing Association, because from what I can gather, it hasn't been decided yet whether to pull the houses down, am I right? So the thing is, being that it hasn't been decided yet, we can put the package together, and when I say we, I mean all of us can put a package together with all our comments and everything in that package, take this package down, give it to whoever's in charge of the City Council, have a meeting with them basically, and say this is what we want in our area.
True.
One of the things I've been doing, my name is Dorothy Clear, is to start looking to how we can take control ourselves of the future of Granby. Mm-hmm. First of all, let me tell you what my credentials are. I was born in this area. I've got a house in German Street. My mother was born in this area. She's 81 now. And so we have a long association going from Cornwallis Street, Berkeley Street, Fulton Street, Marlborough Street, Fire Street. We always live within a mile radius. So I have a real stake in this area. And I want to retire and I want to die in this area. I don't want to be going to some new estate or some place outward. That's why I bought my house 16 years ago, because I wanted to be sure that I was going to stay on in Liverpool Lane. And there are a lot of people like me who want to stay here. Not that we like living in a slummy situation. And that's not caused by the people who live here. Neglected by the corporation, housing association with their houses. That sort of slummy look is caused by them. It's not caused by the people who live in their houses. The fact is, I think it was Jesse Jackson who said, some people may live in the slums, it doesn't mean the slums lives in them. We don't see ourselves as having a slum mentality or a slum intellect. So that's my credential. My other credential is that I've been chair of a housing association. I was chair of the first Black Housing Association in the country in London for 5 years, that's UGMA. So I got some understanding and knowledge of the way the Housing Association movement works. I actually met people like Sir George Young, and I helped to raise funds with our Housing Association and helped to establish the Black Housing Association movement. What you have to realise now is that councils can no longer build houses. Because government's giving all the money to housing associations. And housing associations may protest, but the fact is they all want to be big housing associations. They all want to have the largest possible number of units so they can have the greatest amount of power. You know, and I believe partly the knocking down of Granby is partly to get hold of property as much as anything else. Now, I'm not saying that's the plan for you two, but I think that's what the plan is for your £70,000 a year chief executive and for the Housing Corporation. Because that's the sort of money these people are getting. Chief executives, £50,000, £60,000, £70,000 a year. That's why they don't have to worry about where they live. They can buy what they like, they can build their own house. So I know a bit about the Housing Association movement, and I think that the Housing Association movement, or the housing associations, should not be involved in a survey which they've got such a vested interest in terms of gaining more property and gaining land. If they really want us to have confidence in what they're doing, they should be arranging for somebody that we all jointly agree should do it. And as John said, let's get together and ask the right questions. And that's being done in other areas. So again, that's another credential I've got. I just want to remind you about MIH that says it has no money to do what we would like in the area, like renovate. MIH has bought Runcorn, a whole town. Am I right? And it was in the Echo this week that they're going to renovate over 1,000 kitchens and they're spending £3 million on Halton. They're buying more and more property because that's what they want. They want the properties. They want the units. Why couldn't they have kept that, not bought,
Why could they have not bought Roncall and spent the money on Granby? The fact is there's no shortage of money. You need to know that. It's just that people want to do different things with the money. The same amount of money was there, that was there 20 years ago. So we need to sort of also understand that sort of thing, okay? So they've had £3 million.
Do you mean, if people are speaking, whether it's support or opposition, please can we let them finish?
Okay, so those just about my own personal background. I watched a programme last night called The New Jerusalem. Some of you may have seen it on television. And it showed you people in Kirby, people in Newman Manchester, going through the same process that we're going through. Building up and then the destruction of the areas which they live, and then the building up again. And as one woman said there, they're building us nice houses, but people are unemployed and they can't afford to go anywhere. So they stay indoors. They can't even afford to have the wonderful central heating on. So they stay indoors. They have difficulties going out. The few successes that we saw were success situations where people took control themselves of what they wanted to happen. And that's what I've been exploring, talking to them, the contacts I have in the housing world around the country. And I think the theme's got to be, we want to do it for ourselves. We want to regenerate Granby in a way that fits in with the needs of the great majority of the people here who want to stay. And as has already been said, there's no reason why people who want to move cannot move. We would help, we'd make sure they were rehoused. We would use our muscle to help people to be rehoused if they want to. My view is a lot of people would like to stay as long as they know the area is going to be improved and made distance. I listened to these women last night talking when they were talking about rehousing, and they said what we decided to do is we went around the housing associations and talked to them and said we decided to go out and find out which housing association will deliver the goods that we want. And then we did a deal with them. And they got built in parts of Kirby the sort of estate that suited them and their families and their children. So what we need to go for is regeneration. And the points that Kennedy was making are important in terms of his example of what can do. But in Liverpool, Birmingham, Manchester, London, all over the country, in terms of the housing situation, a lot of people are taking control of making decisions about the way they're fed up with their houses being replanned over their heads continually, and they want to take control themselves. Not from a position of weakness, but from a position of strength. So what we want to move in the direction of, over the next few months, because we're looking to get some resources, we've been promised some funding from some local bodies, is start talking to people about what you would like to see happening in the Granby area. Asking the right questions. Not saying, do you want or do you not don't want demolition. That's no choice for anybody. You know, you need to start from the point of view of what do you want? What would you most like to happen? There's Housing Action Trust, there's Housing Development Trust, there's charitable bodies, we can set up ourselves as a company where everybody can become a shareholder, and from there, we can actually then start getting funds. We can get funds from the Housing Corporation, the Department of the Environment, the City Council, the housing associations themselves, who we could be prepared to negotiate with where we need their help and expertise, and we would want their help and expertise. Let's not kid ourselves. National Council of Voluntary Services, local development agencies and other trusts. There are lots, there's millions of pounds of resources. And some of those resources could be used not only to renovate the property and make the area an area that everybody will want to live in Liverpool, but it could also provide jobs, provide training. Somebody's just mentioned, Paul mentioned another, about EEC money, European money. Now I work at an organisation that actually tells people about European funding and how to get it. Over the next 6 years, there are £600 million available for Merseyside. And we can get some of that money to provide jobs and training so people can get the skills to renovate the area themselves, to renovate the houses. There's no reason at all why some of those houses, the housing associations, can no longer cope with, whatever that may be, cannot be sold or handed over to a trust like ours. So we will see to the renovation. You know, you were saying, Tracy, that the quality of the renovations you did many years ago are not to a high standard. Well, I think a lot of people in the area knew that anyway. I moved into my house 15 years ago and I put a roof on, which has never leaked. I've never had an improvement grant. So, you know, there's always been a question mark over the quality of the repairs and the maintenance and that of housing associations. So all we will say is that, you know, the fact is the thing can be done differently. So what we want to say to you, that there are possibilities in terms of the resources that are available now from national and local agencies for us taking over and developing the area ourselves to suit ourselves. There's lots of ideas come from people in the meetings over the weeks we've been coming here. People want the post office open because if the post office is open, people will get their pensions, they'll spend the money in Granby Street, the shops are having to close. We want a greater variety of shops. When I was a child, Granby Street actually had an antique shop. Can you believe that? So much was the prospect, as well as lots of other shops. It was shops from Princes Avenue right up to Upper Parliament Street. Every shop was selling goods. We could have a market in Granby Street every Saturday. That would bring people into the area because the European community will give you money that will help to bring people into the community. We could have a whole lot of things that would help to restore the area, give people pride in it, give people a say in it, and give them control over what is going on in it. We're talking, though, about partnership of equals, not a partnership where the housing association said, well, we've got the money, so we can do as we like. We're talking about, and that's why we want to set up our own trust and invite the housing associations to be part of that work and invite representation from all the interests in the area, tenants, shopkeepers, homeowners, and other major agencies, the churches and other groups, who also played a very important role often in providing facilities which the council and housing associations have failed to provide. For example, we have a lot of young children in this area, and there is no proper play centre for the children in this area. It's not surprising we have some problems. None of that is built into the plans of the housing association. We have no proper community centre in this area for the whole community. A place where we can all meet and go together and have activities. There's a whole lot of basic amenities lacking. And if people can do it on Broadwater Farm, and they took control, and they're now a Housing Action Trust, and they've had a lot of money from government, like people in Kirby, like people down Park Road who set up cooperatives, we can do it here. So what we'd like to know is that we have the support of everyone, tenants and householders alike, for setting up our own housing action trust, whatever we choose to call it eventually.
No playing field for the kids to play in.
Right, I know one, just for a moment, we'll carry on in a few minutes. I know one or two people have got to leave because they've got commitments at other meetings, so anyone who's got to go now.
Thanks. Referring to what Mr. Hamilton said about these areas, I have been here for such a long time, and I understand what he's talking about. They built houses with gardens, they pulled those houses down. They had houses in Marmaduke Street, they done the same. In Warwick Street, a lot of people were railroaded from this area, and they were moved into Netherley, into some type of houses, which since they've pulled them all down again. If you walk around along Tunnel Road, you will see three-story blocks there, all just about ready to be demolished, and they're standing there, eyesores. Now, Granby's got a few eyesores, or the most of the eyesores are what the Housing Trust created. But there's less eyesores in this area than you can find in a lot of other areas around like this. So I don't know why, really. Okay. Acceptedly that some houses got to be done, etc., etc. About streams on the ground, they're going to demolish certain houses and build back houses on those streams again. Are they going to drain those streams or what?
So
before we move on, can I just generally get a view as to what people generally think about setting up some sort of development trust in order to go, because basically the doorway is, it's only ajar, but it's open. When I spoke to Max Steinberg on Friday, he was definitely
going in a floor.
Well, his opinion is that there has to be some sort of way for partnership, and that seems to be the opinion of most of the people.
The same people who is there, you represent us, we're behind you, 100%.
Right, can I get a
show of hands?
Show of hands for setting up a housing trust in the area. A development trust for everybody to be part of. Right,
As soon as the CEO gets somewhere, they want to push you out. Yeah. But they're not on. They're not on at all.
If anybody's got any questions for the panel, then fire away.
Well, I want just the rubbish moving. Please, if you can do anything.
Right, well, we'll try and do something about that.
Please.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I want them not to demolish the houses.
I think. Can I just say that in our ongoing meetings, while we're getting things moving, it could be very useful for us to invite certain key people from the council, like the head of the Department of the Environment in this council. We want to know, want them here to tell us why they allow the rubbish to lie in the street. That's the person who's responsible for rubbish collecting, for cleaning out rats and mice and all that. I think we should invite people like that here to find out why they're not doing the job. We pay the highest community charge in the country in this city, over £600 a year. And we're entitled to the best service, and we're going to have to fight them all the way for it now.
Right.
I'd like to know from the agents from the housing trusts, if they've got a price for the their new build plan and a price for the rehabilitation of all the houses, including bombs, down to Eversley Street. How could you answer this?
No, we haven't got a price for doing it, because I don't want to harp on the things that we've discussed many times before, but there are no actual plans yet to build new houses or rehab houses. That was just one way of looking at it. I know people think that the secret plans are funny, they've all been cost and so on, but they haven't. We operate an economic climate dictated by central government policy, and as you'll know from your experience, that has shifted the emphasis centrally away from new improvement to new building because of the way they've manipulated the grant rate. So that's the starting point that we're from. Now, you're quite right to say that an active group of people campaigning to people like Max Steinberg, the DOE, and up beyond the minister, could perhaps get those things changed, and the associations are all lobbying to do it. But no, we haven't costed anything out and said this is what it will cost us. We did work out on the computer what outturn rents would be based on the current grant rate for improving property as opposed to building new. And, you know, the model gave a disparity of rents of something like £40 a unit between a rehabbed house and a new build house, and that's purely to do with the way the grant rate operates.
Can you, Andy, then offer any information based on, I mean, obviously you haven't costed the price of building the new houses, but Steinberg has already come out with the wonderful figure that he hasn't got the money to do anything north of Beaconsfield Street. Can you clarify in any way then how it is that he hasn't actually costed this whole thing out? How he knows he hasn't got the money for north of Beaconsfield Street?
Well, I think, I mean, I can't speak for Max Steinberg. I'm not a development person, you know, I'm a local housing manager. But I think what, I would guess what he was trying to say was this, that if you look at how grants are paid and the amount of money that has to be borrowed against the grant for the development and adding things like VAT and other on costs which are done at risk by the developing association, then it gives you high outturn rents. So I think what he's saying is not that the money couldn't be used for rehab, because the money's there, and I suppose you can do anything with it if you bite the bullet and make the decision. It's the bearable other end, you know, the high outturn rent that would cause as an economic rent. Now, there's another issue there, because we touched on rents before. As you know, as we've discussed before, 50% of the tenants in Granby, just over, are secure tenants with a right to a fair rent. And so the economic cost of improving property isn't so much about the, to be completely frank, about the rent that a person would have to pay, for instance, a secure tenant. It's about the economic cost of providing providing that improved house, if you see what I mean.
But
there are ways around
that. Because you can set up a trust where people work cooperatively to do a great deal of that work.
So you then cut
out this business of having to increase rent.
But the one point I would make on your part of the talk, which is you start off by talking about the associations expanding, and I wouldn't argue with you about associations developing more and growing and increasing their asset base. But earlier on you'd mentioned, which is also true, that you'd be providing less units here, not more, so the associations would be likely to lose units.
But exclusively owned by the associations. I don't own any properties, and you go ahead and get rid of 125 owner-occupiers and use own every property that's rebuilt.
I mean, Paul, you speak to Max Downward more than I do, but my understanding was that this package included new build for owner-occupation. I know there's all problems with it, but...
Yeah, but would we get mortgages for them? Who wants to buy a mortgage?
It wasn't just about building for rent.
I think the point that I was trying to make, Andy, was that basically, in order to say that it's not possible to refurbish them, you must be going on the council survey that was done sometime last year. Well, that council survey, although it's never been made public, every now and again somebody bandies a figure about and tells us that in order to refurbish my property, we're talking about something like 47,000. Well, nobody in this room believes that that's real.
That's a lie.
Well, some of us who've improved our houses know that it doesn't cost 47,000.
It doesn't cost that.
You're talking about your labour cost and the way that we...
Those figures are they're based on acquisition costs, development plans, the full improvement, the VAT, the grant rate basis. I don't know these figures. I haven't been producing figures that say 47,000. That's not my job or my expertise.
I'm just an interested observer, if you like, but I think your question may be answered by them. Is it not? I think you have actually mentioned it, that the way the Housing Corporation funds housing associations and the money for the Housing Corporation is government money, but they want to encourage a lot of new build across the country, because when you're building a new building, you've got a fresh set of plans, a fresh piece of land, and you've costed it, and at the end of the day, you know that it is likely to cost that budget figure plus or minus 5-10%. But if you're refurbishing an existing building, you might take down the ceiling and find, oh no, that's £10,000 worth of dry rot. You can't do that. So they just don't like the idea of refurbishment, because it's a big unknown. And therefore they're funding the Housing Corporation, who are funding the housing associations, and encouraging them to do as much new build as possible. So I don't know Max Steinberg, I wish I did, because I'm gonna...
No, you don't wish you did.
But I think that the reason why...
Please, we have a bit of order, please. The gentleman hasn't got a house and he's an architect, and he's here for all of our benefits.
Yeah. Okay.
So I don't know Max Steinberg, but if he gave you a figure of 47,000, maybe he's got that from somewhere. But it may just be that he knows that because of the job that he has, because of the organization that he works in, he knows that it'll be easier for his organization and the housing associations to build new buildings. That is, I may be right, I may be wrong, but that may explain why they've gone along the track of proposing new buildings.
Yeah, but we see, we know the theory of that, but the other thing is, they set standards which are actually ridiculous. In fact, somebody did cost ones. It costed out getting an improvement grant. It was actually cost them more, because this was an architect who was going for an improvement. It cost him more to do his house up, because he was asked to do things that were totally unnecessary in his house than it would, and he cancelled half the grant in the end, doing the house up himself. If the Housing Corporation or the council were to give me 5,000, I could do a hell of a lot of work on my house for that 5,000. But if they came into my house under an improvement grant, they'd want to gut it, remove any old plaster, and they'd probably cost themselves 30,000. And it isn't needed, they're ridiculous. And I think this is why with a sort of trust we'd like to have, we could actually do deals with people who would say, you know, having generally assured ourselves that the roof's okay and the wiring's okay and the house is safe, we give people some money who are either in private tenancies or other, and towards doing the basic things they want doing. And the house next door to me was gutted and stripped. It's owned by, I think, LHT, because I had rows with them for ages, because it was flooding my house while it was empty for 5 years. And I know the previous owner. But the interesting thing, when I went in that house, it was horrible. You'd stripped out all the grates, you'd moved all the character of the house, it just had radiators in the corner, no fireplaces. You know, that's what improvement's about. No one, you know, you can keep it, but the fact is, it's costing far more than it needs to cost. And this is why I think if we took control, we could organise the cost in a way that wouldn't be so high as you're estimating for the cost of doing our houses. But the other thing you've got to remember, these houses have stood 100 years or more. And the houses you're building are not going to stand for 100 years. We've seen some of them falling down already. And that, in long term, is going to be more costly. But the last thing I'd like to say, this city is trying to become the European Architectural City of the Year. And we think working class houses have got as much value as architectural gems as any of the buildings in the centre of the city. And we should be arguing on that basis that we want money to bring our houses up so they look pretty and the areas look nice and tourists will want to come and look at them because we've restored these older houses and kept their nice architectural features. And these are issues too which the housing association should be dealing with, not just building little boxes.
Can I bring this lady in here if you're trying to speak for a long time now?
One of the first points is actually about Liverpool's policy and the housing association's policy about equality of opportunity. I mean, the Granby Triangle is one of the richest areas when it comes to multicultural, multiracial, multi-ethnic population. It has a history, as Dorothy says, some of these houses have stood for 100 years. If you move the self-same house to a nice area in Walton or London, it's worth £40,000 or £50,000. Because it's in Granby Street, because of the way this area is being talked about and run down, deliberately, I think, quite deliberately, I mean, it's been used as a dumping ground for God knows what, and I don't mean the people, because I don't think people are dumped here. I think an awful lot of people choose to live here and they want to live here. I'm one of the people that chose to live here. I bought a house in Granby Street quite deliberately because it was cheaper than renting anything that I've ever rented from LHT or Merseyside Improved Housing. It's a good house. I got it 5 years ago. It was £7,000. The mortgage is £47 a month. I can't get anything equal to that anywhere else that's so nice. But I think, bearing in mind that all of these people have equal opportunity statements that talk about equality of people and equality of chances, why are they deliberately trying to decant this area and destroy a community where black and white and mixed race people and Chinese people and Polish people and all sorts of people live side by side, where people can live in the same street, you know, and own a house next door to people who rent a house. I mean, mostly, you know, areas that are done up by housing associations or by the council, it's all rented, and then, you know, you have an area that's all bought. I mean, there's all sorts of people living here next door to each other here, you know, and there is so much talent, so much joy, and so much love and support in this community, and it just appears to me that the council and the housing associations, hand in hand, are hell-bent to destroy this community. There is not another community like it in Great Britain, and we should not let it go. And it's an architectural tale. There's some absolutely beautiful buildings. And I mean, at one point they wanted to knock down half of Prince's Road. They knocked down houses in Upper Parliament Street and then spent a small fortune building up precisely exactly what they knocked down, and then stuck a bloody plaque on it saying it had been standing since the 1800s. You know, are they going to do the same thing here? It's sick. And I think that under no circumstances, whether we rent, whether we buy, whether we moved here because there was nowhere else to go, or whether we chose to live here, that under no circumstances should we let this go forward. I think that what this gentleman said makes a great deal of sense, and I think what everybody at this table said makes a great deal of sense, and that we actually need to join together and make it into the community that it is desperate to be. If only housing associations would lay off, and the council would lay off, and they would actually look towards their bloody equal opportunities policies that I wouldn't like the arse on to carry on the way that they're doing.
How often do you hear a mugging born in the Grammy Triangle? It's so bad. How long have you heard about a killing won't go on? It's so good. It's so bad. Pensioners don't get mugged. No killings, nothing. And it's so bad. All the killings is going in all these areas where they put up. All these areas where they put up. Killings, you get mugging, you get into the lot. And here it's supposed to be so bad, you never get one of that. Have you heard somebody get mobbed in the Grammy Triangle?
Yeah.
When? Who?
You?
Can I just take this opportunity to thank everyone for attending this evening? I'll just take this opportunity to thank everyone for attending this evening. I know there's a number of people here that haven't been here previously. We have got a collection tin over here for those people that want to make donations. And there will be a meeting here next Wednesday at 7:30 next Wednesday.
Upstairs.
Oh, in the upstairs room. And thanks again for coming. And bring your neighbours.
Just a form
to say that you actually attended this meeting.
And can you sign your name and address it? Because that helps us to be able to come.
Leo from Bantamint. Leo.
Leo.